The mandate to rate does not come from the issuer, but it is coming from a third party like a fund manager. We call it as unsolicited rating because we are going to do a rating without any cooperation from the company. We are going to rate based on the information what we have and also based on the request. So such are called unsolicited. But whatever we have it in public domain, whatever you see, more 99.9% is solicited rating, where the company gives a mandate to do a rating. We also have external ratings and internal ratings. This word why I had highlighting is, suppose we also use ratings, banker also use ratings, the word. Banker, what happens when they lend money, they need to have a requirement how to price that, what charge, interest charge they should charge. And secondly, they also provide capital. Whenever they lend money, they need to keep capital for that. So for this purpose, they need to have evaluation internally done. So such that they do their own credit appraisal process and then they rate a company. They are called internal ratings. But whenever you use ratings given by external agencies like us, that is called external rating. We also call probability of default. It's very important, this differentiation. We call it as a default, all rating agencies, if there is a delay of even one day, and even if there is a default of 1 rupee. Suppose, let's say that the amount that you have borrowed is falling due on 30th September. Let's say 10 crore is to be paid on 30th September. Instead of 30th September, you have paid it on 1st October. Then it is a default. Because on 30th September, you are supposed to make the payment. You have not made the payment, so it is a default. Similarly, you have out of 10 crores, you have paid 9 crores. 1 crore you have missed out. Still, even 1 rupee, if you have not paid, it is called a default. Well, if you look at a banker, for the purpose of definition, they only call it if it is delayed beyond 90 days, then only they call it as a default. You will find that is why sometimes rating agencies, what they show it as a default, you will find that banks are not showing as a, they will continue to call it as a standard asset. They don't call it as a substandard NPA. They don't call it as an NPA. We have rating scales, AAA, AA+, etc. Rating versus grading. Sometimes you find you have also rating product and grading product. There's a small difference. If a real estate developer wants to take a loan, he takes a rating. But at the same time, sometimes a particular project he wants to get it graded. He's not taking borrowing, but he wants to communicate to the people who want to buy, saying that how far this quality of the project. So what we try to do is that it's ability of the company to complete the project on time, and also as per specifications we try to assess whether he will be able to provide the same specification what he has promised in the literature. Then we give a grading, but we never comment on the payment, outstanding loan, whether he will be able to pay, etc. in the grading. Of course, we take into account his financial track record, performance, etc. there. Issue rating and issuer rating are highlighted. We also have standalone rating and structured obligation rating. If a company, standalone basis, we say that overall quality of the company is AA, but he provides certain credit enhancement in the form of additional collaterals, maybe in the form of escrow of cash flows, or sometimes pledge of shares, or sometimes certain guarantee from a third, another company which enjoys a AAA. Then we provide credit enhancement for that, then we call it as a AAA. So that time when we provide credit enhancement, standalone it is AA, but after credit enhancement it is SO. So we have a suffix called SO, structured obligation. So we don't say it is standalone basis, it's a AAA rating. But based on credit enhancement, since we have a provided upgrade, so we call it as a SO rating. Then we use bond rating, bank loan rating, MSME rating. Each one has a different meaning for the purpose. I quickly now move. This is a typical rating scale which we have for a manufacturing company, AAA, AA, CDB, BBB, etc. Each rating scale has also a modifier. So if you say plus or minus, we use AA plus or AA minus. So this plus or minus is called modifier. So for a AAA rating, there are no modifiers, whereas other rating items like from AA to C, you have modifiers, plus and minus. So these are all used for long-term ratings. This type of rating scale is only used for whenever there is a borrowing beyond 1 year. If it is less than 1 year, we have a different rating scale. Every rating agency have a certain process. At PCOC also, we follow a certain process in terms of pre-rating. For example, there is a standard rating agreement. We don't change the rating agreement between the company and the rating agency for depending upon the client. It's a standard format which goes to all the people. It's a must that we communicate certain. For example, we highlight in that agreement how a rating agency will maintain the confidentiality of the information. And what is expected from the company in order to carry out the rating, what information is required by them. Also, recently there is a requirement from SEBI that once you do a rating, mandatorily we have to disclose the rating. Whether a company accepts it or not, once we take a mandate for rating and once we complete it, suppose the company gets a BBB rating, the company may feel it is BBB plus or A minus, they can appeal. But even after appeal, suppose the rating committee decides that it is the same rating, then they have to go ahead and publish it in public domain. We don't have a choice. So that is the new requirement. The acceptance of rating is independent of that rating agency has the role to publish it. Like that.
What is the role, Peter?
Yeah, I think it's a good question. What we do is, whenever a company is not paying fee, we are given permission to put it under a non-cooperation by the issuer. So we have a separate class. We have rated a company, say A, and the company has not paid fee or not provided information, then we classify that company with a suffix along with the rating. Suppose the company is currently enjoying BBB plus, let us say. Just before that, there is a prefix. Very clearly, it will say non-cooperation by the issuer. And then WB plus it will still say. So,
sir, you collect your fees in advance. Is the question on before?
Nice one.
So, पहले पैसा लेते हैं और बाद में तो हाथ लगाते हैं.
हाँ. I think it's a good question. What happens?
Very rarely
they do question. Otherwise,
advance. Yeah, when it comes for the first time, suppose a bond is rated for a 5 year bond. They have initial rating fee. During the tenure of yearly payment of annual surveillance fee is required. That time, if the surveillance fee is not paid, this question arises. But in the case of a bank loan rating, year on year, there is a fresh case because the sanctions are revised by the bank, etc. So every year it is equal to the initial rating, so the rating agency takes the payment and then only carry out the activities. But good question. Then similarly, during the rating process, we have certain. So we have a rating policy which we put it in website. We use criteria. For example, we say criteria for rating a manufacturing company. These are the parameters which we use. Then we cannot change the criteria for one company to another company. We have to consistently use the same criteria for rating a manufacturing company. In case we change the rating criteria, then we have to publish it in the revised criteria what we have put it in public. So that way there are requirements for us also, and we also, as part of best practice, we always do that right from the beginning. At rating committee, the analyst recommends and then the rating committee gives a verdict. So it is not an individual who takes the decision, it is a rating committee which takes the decision of rating. Basically, to ensure that there is no individual bias in the rating process. So we make sure that. So this way, the post rating, after rating is complete, we publish it in public domain. And then during the tenure of the instrument, we have to continuously monitor if there are any changes in the environment due to business, industry, management, and financial factors. The rating agency will ask for further clarification and they can revise the rating in the form of upgrade, downgrade, or review. So that's a continuous process. In case the rating, the amount is paid, there is no loan outstanding, then we withdraw the rating as well. It's a typical dating process where you find a mandate is signed with the issuer, then we commence the information requirement with the client, then take it to management meetings, analysts take it, discuss with the management, ask for a lot of clarification based on the research. Then they go and use our standard criteria to assess the company and evaluate, and then they put it up the recommendation for the committee. And then we assign, in case there is an appeal, it is reconsidered for the committee. And if there is any changes based on the appeal, yes, we take a revised review, otherwise we reaffirm the rating. And this way this rating process continues. This is a very important slide. I thought it's very important. We also have it in the website. When we look at a rating, there are four broad parameters which are considered. What we call business risk, industry risk, financial risk, and management risk. These are the four broad parameters. Whichever company we rate, these four broad parameters will come. And within the broad risk, possibly certain parameters will change. For example, if I say business risk, in the case of a pharmaceutical company, we may have a requirement of looking at capacity utilization, whether a company is 85% or 90% or 95%. Whereas the same parameter of capacity utilization for a fertilizer industry could be different. What is seen as a good at 90% capacity utilization for a so-called a pharmaceutical company, for a fertilizer NPK plant, even at 110%, it may not be good. The score what is given, even the parameter used is the same, it could be different for industry to industry. Similarly, the capacity utilization may not be there for an infrastructure company when we do an assessment. That could be a different parameter in the business risk. But the four broad parameters will be used, but the weight which is assigned for within those broad parameters, various elements could vary. And those elements also could vary depends upon the industry or depends upon the sector. But what I call it as, we have four broad sectors, if you look at it on the outer line, financial sector, manufacturing sector, infrastructure sector, and government and local bodies. Because the same four parameters, depending upon the broader segment, the parameters within that could vary. So that is why we kept it separate. So a company can be a financial sector company or a manufacturing company, but we use these four parameters. And a rating can be based on solicited or unsolicited. It could be based on long-term or short-term. It could be a rating of an individual loan or rating of your housing loan portfolio. It could be issuer or issue rating. Again, the complexities in terms of rating a short-term and a long-term is different. When you do a short-term rating, what we do the company's rating as it is for done for a long-term. Then we also use for a shorter period, maybe monthly cash flows, etc. Then we transfer that long-term rating into a short-term rating by way of mapping. So even though we do a company short-term loans, we have to do the long-term rating and then convert it into a short-term mapping scale. This is very important because initially I said the information provided by the company is very critical. The information that is exchanged is higher, then it is very good for the company. Because if a lesser information, lack of information sometimes can create what you call lack of understanding for the analyst. So the higher the information given to the analyst, the better the understanding and the better the rating could be. So we say that certain financial information, certain business plans, certain information about the manufacturing facility, who are the top customers, who are the top suppliers, all this information we seek from the company. Quite often, sometimes certain small companies, they try to think that, it is a confidential information that I cannot share it. But if the client base, if the company is good, suppose if they are supplying to very high-end clients, the customer base, if the quality is good, it gets a better view, rather than somebody is supplying to Pepsi, Coke, etc. Then there are some international companies and the volume could be there and the potential for growth is very high, rather than another small bottling company which is they are supplying. So it's important that who is your customer base. So maybe if you have the supplier's name, you will be able to understand that whether there is a sustainability of continuous ability for the company to get the raw materials in place. So both are very critical. So we ask for a lot of information during the rating process. The higher the information, the better for the rating analyst to understand the company. The better understanding will translate it possibly into a better rating as well. We have a strong information recovery. We ask for a lot of information. Whatever is not relevant, we just leave it. For example, if the company has entered into a derivatives contract, they should provide that information. Because reading a company with no derivatives exposure and reading a company with derivatives exposure is completely different. You know that in 2009, due to this derivatives, many companies in the country, they lost huge money. In fact, the total loss at that time for the corporate sector was close to 1 lakh crores.
Wow.
It's not a small money. Huge loss they had incurred at the time. In fact, I remember one of the textile company in Coimbatore. It took 20 crores to build a net worth of 100 crores. They worked hard. But in one wrong derivatives contract, they lost the entire net worth. So I think it's those sort of information we seek. Sometimes the company provides, sometimes they don't provide. You'll find the sometimes, you know, the company has been rated BBB, suddenly it has been brought to a D. How come the rating agency, are they sleeping? Why should be a sudden fall in the rating? If the company is not providing such disclosure in terms of derivatives contract, and that is translated into a sudden loss for the company, we may not be able to fight it out like that. Similarly, for chartered accountant is there, it would be good if they provide a lot of information in the audited reports, because the better interpretation of the financial numbers would help the rating agencies also certain. Like today, as per Revised Companies Act, there are a lot of changes. The current asset and current liability definition itself. Because it's based on a business cycle, the working capital, the current asset and current liability. Earlier, anything below 1 year, either it's asset or liability, it is called a current asset or current liability. But now, as per the new Companies Act revision, revised regulation, it can be based on a business cycle. A business cycle can be for 24 months. Still, they can be, depends upon that period, they have to classify it as a long term or a short term. So, this discloses, if it is there in the balance sheet, about the business cycle, how they are considering as part of notes, it would be very, very useful, because sometimes what happens is a company, sometimes when we do various ratio analysis, a current ratio is also one of the critical ratio we look at. Certain companies, because of the long business cycle, etc., and because of their revised disclosure requirement under Companies Act, they may show you a very poor current ratio. When it is compared with pre-2013, the sudden change can be seen that there is a sudden deterioration in the company's performance, which is not the case. It is because of the new disclosure requirement there is a change in requirement. If there are any changes, if that information is available as part of audited reports, it will be very useful. Sometimes we also seek the clarification from the chartered accountants, which our company, their own chartered accountants. We talk to them, try to explain. But sometimes the chartered accountants are also very busy. They don't have time to go into detail. So my appeal to some of the chartered accountants here is that possibly, if you feel that it is in the interest of the client to provide that information, that would be really useful while capturing the ratings. We also say that when we do a rating, we also look at the corporate governance. So what we believe is, however the company is good, but if it is not combined with good practices, the sustainability of the business model is not there. Similarly, however the governance is good, if it is not backed by a good business model, again the sustainability is not there. So the combination of good governance and good business model is very critical for the sustainability of the business. We have seen that very large companies, because of poor governance, they go off. Classic cases like United Breweries or whatever we call it, Kingfisher. I would say this is not to do with the governance. It's nothing to do with the company was doing well, but there was some diversion of funds. There was a lot of violent diversifications, I will call it. Such as led to sudden downfall. So that's all because of governance. I just given some examples there. I just given, these are like a textbook it may look, but each one has a lot of relevance. For example, when we say business risk, we look at two broad parameters, the market share. Then when you say market share, some of the company is engaged in auto ancillaries. Within that auto ancillaries, within a particular segment, say let us say steering, manufacturing steering means, then what is the market share within that company? This company's market share. We don't say market share alone is critical, but market share combined with what you call the pricing they enjoy, that is very critical. Sometimes having a good market share has no meaning if they are not able to command a good price. It's just not volume, it is also combined with the price premium, because the market share or the market position helps to understand how dominant a player within that industry. So sometimes the question will come that I've been in the business for 30 years, I have not missed out payment. But what is important is you don't look at on a standalone basis how far, how long you are there in the business, but also you look at within your peer group, where is your position. Within the overall universe of companies, what is your position? It is very, very important. Because standalone, we don't look at company, it is also relative in nature. There are two important facts when we look at a rating. One is it is relative rating. How far this particular company related to other companies, that is one. Second, it is also forward looking. Just purely not based on historical behavior of the company in terms of financial performance, etc. But it's also a lot to do with the ability of the company to perform in the future. However, there is sudden regulatory changes. Let's say GST is coming. There are certain companies which may be impacted, certain sectors may be impacted. Such companies may have a very good past, but going forward it can have a different outlook. So it has to be seen that rating is always forward-looking. If there is any changes in the regulatory environment, certain changes because of leadership team moving out, certain changes that can happen because of what you call high leveraging, suddenly the company has borrowed, so the sudden borrowings, it tilts the leveraging, can tilt higher financial costs, as a result the profitability can come down. So the sudden changes can impact the company. So we can't ignore some of this in the when we do a relative ranking. Similarly, industry risk, the important point here is, howsoever a company is very good on a standalone basis within the industry, but if the industry itself, it is a sunset industry, you may find, you can't say that the company on a standalone basis can do well if the industry is belonging to a sunset. Similarly, an average company, which is part of a sunrise industry, may be rated better than a very good company in the sunset industry. So industry is very critical for us, because it's like, you see, I don't know, some people who are startup companies, they will say that it is not only somebody is getting 70% marks, but also equally important that each paper they have to have minimum of 50% or 45% they have to score. So similarly here, however the company is good standalone, but also they are required to have that part of, fortunately part of a particular industry. There are, we know certain industries like textile, for example, they were once upon a time, they were a very good industry. Today look at the textile scenario. It's completely different. It's no longer a sunrise industry. Today it has become scalability is so important there. Management risk is very important. Quite often small companies is managed by individuals. When we look at a company, there is a need that there is, over a long term, we look at the ability of the company to sustain and compete in the marketplace. So there is a need that beyond that individual, there is a management team, there is a succession plan which is very critical to see whether the company would be able to sustain over a longer period. Quite often this we find where closely held companies have this issue. They don't bring professionals in the company. I'm not saying professionals add more value compared to the so-called promoters. Promoters, there is a skin in the game, whereas when you look at professionals, they come and go because they take salaries and go. That's one view. Having said that, it is important that if the promoters are also able to bring professionals that have the control, necessary control, that they are also doing the job properly, then that combination is good because it provides a continuity, business continuity, and also a broader expertise that is required for running a business. Of course, financial risk is finally whatever industry you belong, whatever company you run, whatever type of business model you have, whatever management you have, finally it should translate into financial performances. A debt equity of 0.5 is better than debt equity of 2:1. Whatever company, whatever be the nature of the promoters, etc., we have to agree. Because the company's debt is lower, the ability to repay is higher, so we can't ignore that. So always profitability, your net worth, your ROCE, all these numbers will translate very clearly in terms of outlook for repayment. We only look at from a repayment of debt. We don't comment on the company's ability to provide a higher return for the shareholders. We don't talk about equity shareholders here. We only talk about, from a purely fundamental perspective, the ability of the company to repay. I just go through this. I don't want to get into details. I come to the key 10 points, which possibly if you can register in your mind, it is very useful. I think this is what somebody was asking me. One of the members here, the committee members, asked me that tell us what is to be done to get a better rating. I think these are the 10 mantras. First is the strengthening the business model. Today, a company may be operating within a region. So if they have to grow, maybe it's required they have to go beyond the region. So since they are already a number one in the region, maybe one has to look at beyond the region, then beyond the country. Secondly, a company may be operating in a particular product. There may be certain levels by beyond which you can grow in that particular product. Can you think of diversifying into other products also? Because the growth comes out of expansion in terms of geographies, in terms of products, and new lines of business, whatever you can take. So I think it is important that the strengthening the business model is a continuous process. It's just not one time. It has to be continuous. In fact, there are always questions come. Like, if you look at Ambuja Cements, they have a cement manufacturing plant at the coastal parts of Gujarat. So why they have chosen? Because they found that their raw material and finished goods, there is a huge transportation cost is involved. And for a cement industry, if transportation cost is higher, then certainly the margins will come under terrific pressure. So they have decided to keep the plant in a coastal area. So they have taken. So it is a big advantage over other cement manufacturers because they have it in a coastal area. But at the same time, the downside is, suppose something like a tsunami which hit Tamil Nadu, so it can hit very badly. That is a downside. So there is always, every growth, it comes with certain risk also. Somebody going into for the purpose of growth, they diversify business into in the form of violent diversification, which is unrelated. Somebody who is doing a manufacturing business get into a real estate business. It's completely unrelated for them. Though it helps the company to grow top line, but sometimes unrelated diversification can destroy value for the company. So they have to be very conscious. The growth comes with pain. Growth comes with a lot of risk involved. If somebody wants to operate outside the country, there are a lot of other risks which are currency risks. Suppose an Indian company has a unit in Nigeria, let us say, and then they have invested 100 crores. And the Nigerian company also subsidiary is growing. They have shown 40% growth in sales, 40% growth in PAT. But there is a sudden depreciation in the value of Nigerian currency. What will happen? what you have put 100 crores into, if it's a 40% depreciation, you are going to show it at 60 crores. Overnight, you are going to lose money. So the currency risk is very high when somebody is going to operate in the international market. Howsoever, somebody is good. For example, I give a interesting case study where one of the Japanese company entered into US market, and you find that because of, I'm talking about when yen was depreciated, they were competing with American companies. The sudden so-called depreciation of yen, they got a competitive advantage. The American company, which was enjoying very clearly, very well, the moment yen was depreciated, they become less competitive. So they decided to go and invest $2 billion so that their capital expenditure would help them to improve the efficiency of operations so that they bring down the overall cost. They become competitive again after spending $2 billion as capex. After they invested $2 billion and implemented the project, they were very happy, they are good. But what happened was, once again, the yen was depreciated. All their efforts went. This is a caterpillar. It's a caterpillar versus a Japanese yen. So when somebody is operating in the international market, howsoever your business model is good, you'll find you may have to face challenges because of currency risk, political risk, economy risk. These are also there when it is operated outside the country. That's why when Tata set up steel operations also in the country, when everybody appreciated, oh, we have become an Indian multinational company, it has become a global major, etc. But when Europe is under recession, you find that Tata Steel has such a large problems. It is not Indian operations which is making losses, but the European operation is adding losses for the company. The so-called diversification which has gone for expansion, which is seen by everybody as good at that particular point of time, the same operation is not good today. So it is completely different. So the business model of a company, is it? Time is short. Yeah, thank you. I'm on the last slide. Thank you. So our friend has said that 5 minutes, so I'll just take 5 minutes for now. The second is, please have a benchmark yourself. I'm operating within a particular industry, maybe auto ancillary or a textile or maybe infrastructure, whatever. Within that industry, what is your position? Suppose currently you are in sixth position, can you move into fifth position, fourth position? Try to benchmark and then you move up. Because by moving up within the peer group, naturally you will also move up in the overall chain. Then raising the management, level of management standards, because it's very, very important. We all know that we have a large experience in a particular company. We sit on the laurels of yesteryears, but economy around us, environment around us is continuously changing. So there is a continuous learning which is required. We have to continuously improve our own standards. I think that is very important because however we are qualified, however we have experience, however we are in the marketplace with long time, but there is a need for continuous improvement there. Benchmarking the financial performance. Sometimes I'm within a particular industry, I'm the number one in terms of financial ratios. But don't stop within your industry when you are benchmarking the financial performance. You try to look at beyond the industry, look at the global, all companies put together, where are you? My interest coverage ratio is, last year I was 2.5, this year it is 3, so I improved better. My industry average is 2.75, I'm better than the industry. So you feel that my interest coverage ratio 3 is very good as compared to peers in the industry, and also I've done better than the last year. But look at the other companies. There are companies which are having interest coverage ratio of 6, 8, 10. How do I reach it there? How do I improve my DSR? How do I improve my debt equity ratio? I think when we look at financial performance, you have to look at benchmarking with the rest of the players, not just necessarily in the within your industry. Then enterprise-wide risk management. So earlier we know certain risk only we look at, but across the company, what are all the various types of risks that can impact the company? It could be arising out of competition, it can be arising out of poor quality products, it can be arising out of integrity of people, it can be arising out of regulatory risk. It is important to understand what risk can pull you down. Try to focus on that and try to resolve those issues. Governance, of course, is important. Ability to manage multiple geographies, cultures, territories, and regulation. Corporate social responsibility is very important. Today, what happens if a company has to do well in the long run? Howsoever, they are doing earning better, but also their role, commitment towards society is very critical. So the sustainability, for example, green projects, investment for green revolution, you have to be part of it. It cannot be like independent of that. In fact, some of the global banks, unless there is a green initiative, they don't even lend money to some of the companies. So they have a new practice that every company where they lend, unless they have a green initiative, they don't even participate.